فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
The authorships is now what we're going to move on to, speaking about the works that have been written in this particular timing. Because if you learn the books that are written at this particular time as a student of knowledge, it gives you fiqh and understanding and how to study the madhab and or how to even be gradual in learning. As we mentioned, the Hashi of Ibn Abidin is what is the Bawrul Istiqrar. I'm now going to mention, inshaAllah ta'ala, the books that are most important in the Hanafi madhab now. Okay? Ahamul mu'allafat fil fiqh al-Hanafi. The most important books in the Hanafi madhab. Brothers, it is the kutub of Muhammad al-Hasan al-Shaybani, which are referred to as what? Bidhahir al-Riwayah. It's called what? It's called Zahir al-Riwaya. This is the umdah, the reliance of the Hanafi madhab is in these, the books of him, his books, Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. And the most important book of Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani is Al-Mabsut. So pay attention, there are two kitabs that are written that are known as Al-Mabsut in the Hanafi madhab. Two kitabs. The first one is Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani's one. And the next one is called Al-Mabsut, written by As-Sarakhsi, As-Sarkhasi. Sarkhasi has a kitab called Al-Mabsut. He died in 483. The one Muhammad al-Hasan al-Shaybani wrote, we said it's called what? Al-Aslu, right? He also has, Muhammad al-Hasan al-Shaybani, he has a kitab called Ziyadat. He has a kitab called Al-Jami'u al-Saghir. He has a what? Al-Jami'u al-Kabir. He also has Al-Sayr al-Saghir, Al-Sayr al-Kabir. Are you there? All of these six books, Al-Aslu, Al-Ziyadat, Al-Jami'u al-Saghir, Al-Kabir, Al-Sayr al-Saghir, and Al-Sayr al-Kabir. These six books, which are called Zahir al-Riwaya, all of them are summarized in one book. It's all summarized in the kitab Al-Kafi. It's all summarized in the Kitab Al-Kafi, written by Al-Hakim Al-Shaheed. Also the Kitab Mukhtasar Al-Tahawi. Al-Imam Al-Tahawi has a Mukhtasar, we mentioned it. It's another Kitab which is very important that a student of knowledge within the Hanafi Madhab gives importance to. So we're mentioning the books, six books, and who summarized all of it? Al-Hakim Al-Shaheed. We're now moving on to the other kitab, which is Mukhtasar al-Tahawi. Al-Imam al-Tahawi's Mukhtasar. He even placed a sharah on it, sharah al-Mukhtasar al-Tahawi. By who lakin? Al-Jassas, Abu Bakr al-Jassas, who died in 370 Hijriya. There's also another kitab called Mukhtasar al-Quduri, which I mentioned. This kitab, Mukhtasar al-Quduri, the Hanafiyya, they gave importance to it, a high importance, ihtimaman kabiran. This kitab has been given, it has been given a lot of explanation, a lot of ta'liqat, and a lot of hawashi and hawam, emission, etc. So this kitab, Mukhtasar al-Qudur, you see a lot of Hanaf studying it. From the kitabs are Tuhfatul Fuqaha by Samarqandi. This kitab, Mukhtasar, Tuhfatul Fuqaha, written by Samarqandi, it goes back to the Mukhtasar al-Quduri. It's basically a tawdih of the mushkilat. He's explaining the ambiguity and the vague things that are in the Mukhtasar al-Quduri, the kitab Tuhfatul Fuqaha by Samarqandi. And he added on some extra things, of course. Kasani is the one who done a sharah on that. He placed a sharah on Tuhfatul Fuqaha by Samarqandi. Kasani did. And he called it Bada'i'u al-Sana'i'. And this kitab is a kitab which is mu'tamad. It's a kitab which is truly relied on. And it's very nice the way it explains the madhahib, the madhab and the aqwal that it holds. There's another kitab, a matan, a small matan, which is called Bidayatul Mubtadi, written by Marghinani. Many ulama have gone to that book Bidayat al-Mubtadi by Barghinani, and they placed shuruh on it, and they made it their mu'awwal, their reference point. And one of the shuruh that has been placed on the Bidayat al-Mubtadi is the Al-Hidayah, which is the sharh of the Bidayah. So the author, he explained his own kitab and he called it what? He called it Al-Hidayah. And it's the kitab which we mentioned that the Hanaf, they went extreme on it. They said, إِنَّ الْهِدَايَةَ كَالْقُرْآنِ قَدْ نَسَّقَتْ مَا أَلَّفُ قَبْلَهَا فِي الْكُتُبِ مَا أَلَّفَ مِثْلَهَا فِي الْكُتُبِ فَاحْفَظْ قَوَاعِدَهَا وَاسْلُكْ مَسَالِكَهَا تَسْلَمْ مَقَالُكَ مِنْ زَيْغٍ وَمِنْ كَذِبِ. They said, Kitab al-Hidayah is like the Qur'an. It abrogated all the other fiqh books. There's no need. Shafi'iyah always, there's a rivalry between Shafi'iyah and the Hanaf. So the Shafi'iyah, they said, this is the Qur'an of the Hanaf. Our Qur'an. The Qur'an is the abrogated. صح? So this Kitab al-Hidayah means a lot. ولذلك, if you look at Imam if you look at Nasb al-Raya by Zayla'i, it's the takhrij al-hadith al-Hidayah. He does the takhrij of the Kitab al-Hidayah's ahadith that he uses, the shuruh, the sharh of, he explains it, he goes in it. Also from the shuruh that have been placed on the works that have been put on the Hidayah itself. The Hidayah became the multi, there's over 70 works have been put on the Kitab al-Hidayah, over 70. From them is Al-Babarti. He has a kitab called Al-Babarti, has a kitab called Al-Inaya, which is the sharh of Hidayah. There's also, and there are many other books. But the most clearest, the most simplest sharh of it is the Fathul Qadir by Kamal ibn Hammam, who died in the year 861. We're now going to move on to, the books are so much within the madhab. There are many shuruh, shahawashi, mutud, ta'aliqat, tahqiqat that a talib al-ilm later can go into and see for himself. We're now going to move on to the mustalahatul hanafiyyati fi kutubihim. The hanaf, they have terms which they use in their books. There are terms which they would use in their books. Such as the term Al-Imam. Qala al-Imam, an al-Imam, inda al-Imam. Who do they mean by that? They mean, of course, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. The word Imam for them is Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala. Or the term Al-Imam al-A'zam. The word Al-Imam al-A'zam for them is who? Fainam yuriduna bihi Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. They intend by that Al-Imam Abu Hanifa. Also from those terms is Al-Imam al-Thani. Okay, they use that term as well. They would use that. Al-Imam al-Thani. Some of them would say, Inda al-Imam al-Thani. Or they would say, even al-Thani. Just say the word Thani. Or they would say, Ani al-Thani. If you find that in the books of the Hanaf, the usage of this word, Ani al-Imam al-Thani, or al-Thani, or Ani al-Thani, or Ani al-Imam al-Thani, they mean Abu Yusuf rahimahullah. They mean who? Abu Yusuf. If they say al-thalith, just three, thalith, or third, or they say al-imam al-thalith, the third imam, they mean by this who? Muhammad ibn al-Hassan al-Shaybani. Also they say about him, Muhammad Hassan al-Shaybani, they say Al-Imam al-Rabbaniyu. If they say Qala Al-Imam al-Rabbaniyu, Al-Imam al-Rabbani, they mean Muhammad Hassan al-Shaybani. If they say Al-A'immatu al-Thalatha, the three Imams, who do they mean? When they say Al-A'immatu al-Thalatha, this is clear, right? Who they mean by it? Of course, Abu Hanifa, Abu Yusuf, and Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. These are the three imams that they're referring to. So in the itlaq, unrestrictedly, when they say al-a'immatu al-thalatha, the Hanaf, who do they mean? Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, Abu Yusuf, and Abu Hanifa. So don't think to yourself when you're reading the Hanafi book, Al-Aimatu Thalatha, that they mean the other three Imams, or Shafi'i and Ahmed and Imam Malik. These are the jahalat that sometimes people come with when they read books. Yeah? For example, when A'imma say in their books, Qala al-Ashab. Hey, what do they mean by al-Ashab? Yeah? The Ashab said. You might think, some people say, well, the Sahaba said this. Yeah? Are you with me, brothers? Al-Ashab, they mean the followers of the madhab, or the followers of, or the students of the Imam of the madhab. Huh? So they don't mean it's the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have to realize. When they say al-Shaykhan, the two sheikhs, for example, they say, وَعِنْدَ الشَّيْخَيْنِ خِلَافًا لَهُ. عِنْدَ الشَّيْخَيْنِ, the two sheikhs. Who do they mean? They mean Abu Hanifa and Abu Yusuf. So when they say, عِنْدَ الشَّيْخَيْنِ خِلَافًا لَهُ, the two sheikhs, there's a khilaf basically against them. Who's the person that they're saying against them? Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. Khilafan lahu, they refer to Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. Shaykhain here means Abu Yusuf and Abu Hanifa. Khilafan lahu, they mean Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. So the term al-Shaykhan, عندنا حناف يطلق على الإمام Abu Hanifa to Abu Yusuf. If you hear them say, for example, وعنده كذا, عنده, next, with him is this. وعند الصاحبين كذا, and the two students are this. Who do they mean? The صاحبين, they mean here, who? So the صاحبين, the two صاحبs, they mean here, who? Abu Yusuf and Muhammad Hassan al-Shaybani, because they're the ashab of Imam Abu Hanifa. When they say, the other term that they use is al-akharaini, akharaini, akharaini. Who do they mean, the akharaini, the other two? وَعِنْدَ الْآخَرَيْنِ. Yeah? Again, they mean Abu Yusuf and Muhammad ibn al-Hassan al-Shaybani. When they say, for example, وَقَالَ الطَّرَفَانِ كَذَا خِلَافًا لَهُ. When they say tarafani, the two edges, the two sides, the two sides. Who do they mean the tarafani? They mean Abu Hanifa and Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. Abu Yusuf is not on the side, he's in the middle. The two sides are al-Imam, because remember, who did we say was the first one? Al-Imam Abu Hanifa. Who's next? Abu Yusuf. Who's last? So who's on two sides? Ah, that's it. At-Tarafan, they mean al-Imam Abu Hanifa on one side and Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani on one side. And Abu Yusuf is wasat, he's in the middle. So sometimes when they both agree, is they will say ittafaqat tarafani. The two groups, the two sides have agreed on this. If they say wa inda ashabina, when the Hanaf say according to our ashab, our followers, this is what we believe. Who do they mean ashab? Here they mean the a'immatu thalatha, the three a'imma. Who are the a'immatu thalatha? Abu Hanifa, Abu Yusuf, and Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. Or sometimes they might mean by that the fuqaha of the madhab who believe this. They could mean that sometimes. When they say Shamsul A'imma, the son of the A'immas, who do they mean? Shamsul A'imma. Shamsul A'imma. Who do they mean? They mean As-Sarkhasi, ama As-Sarkhasi, however you want to say it. Like if they say Shamsul A'imma Al-Halwani, they will restrict it. They can't leave it unrestricted if they want to say somebody other than Sarkhasi or Sarkhasi. Unrestrictedly, Qala Shamsul A'imma, they mean Sarkhasi or Sarkhasi. If they say Shaykhul Islam, the Hanaf, when they say Shaykhul Islam, who do they mean? Ibn Taymiyyah? No. They mean Ibn Abidin. Ibn Abidin. Sorry. They mean Abu Bakr ibn Khawahir Zada, as Ibn Abidin mentioned. Ibn Abidin mentioned that, sorry, in his Radd al-Muhtar. They mean Abu Bakr Khawahir Zada, who died in 483. So when they say Shaykh al-Islam, that's who they mean. Abu Bakr Khawahir is who they mean. Ibn Abidin mentions that, sorry. Abu Muhammad al-Qurashi, who died in 775, he said, no, the Ahnaf, when they say Shaykh al-Islam, they don't mean Abu Bakr ibn Khawahir. They mean Ali ibn Muhammad. Ali ibn Muhammad al-Isbijani. Al-Isbijabi, sorry. Ali ibn Muhammad al-Isbijabi. Who died in 535. So here we find Ibn Abidin took the opinion that it's meant by one particular person, and Al-Qurashi, he held that it was referred to another person. When they say Fakhrul Islam said this, Fakhrul Islam said this, yeah? Who are they referring to? They're referring to Abu al-Usr. The person who they're referring to here is Abu al-Usr al-Bazdawi. Because the Bazdawiyani are two. There's one called Abu al-Usr and there's another one called Abu al-Yusr. Abu al-Usr and Abu al-Yusr. The two individuals. The reason why Abu al-Usr was called Abu al-Usr is because his works are very hard. The Usri Ta'lifi is hard. His works are very hard. Usr, shiddah and hardship is in it. Whereas Abu al-Yusr, his works are easy and simple and summarized and to the point. What about when they say Sadr al-Sharia? Sadr al-Sharia, Sadr al-Sharia. When they say Sadr al-Sharia, they mean Ubaydullah al-Mahbubi, who died in 745 or 747. When the Ahnaf used the word salaf, the term salaf, وَعِنْدَ السَّلَفِ كَذَا, and with the salaf is this. What do they mean by that? They mean anybody from Abu Hanifa, from Abu Yusuf, or from Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, any one of them. Salaf to them is that. That's their salaf. If they say khalaf, who do they mean? They mean anybody between Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani and al-Halwani. If they say, so the khalaf, that's what it means to them. It's between Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani and al-Halwani. Are you with me? If they say al-Mutaakhiruna, it means anyone after Al-Halwani. Even Zufar would enter Salaf for them. Does that make sense? So anybody between Muhammad Abu Hanifa, Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, and Abu Yusuf, and Zufar, any one of those are Salaf. Between Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, from Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani and al-Halwani, this is Khalaf. Anyone below al-Halwani is Mutaakhir. It's called Mutaakhirin. They say al-Mutaakhirun al-Salih. What about when they say if they use the word Mustalah al-Mashayikh, the Mashayikh. The Mashayikh to them is any Imam who didn't reach Abu Hanifa. When they use the word, there's another term which they use, is called al-ammah. Ammah. What does al-ammah mean? Ammah, عند العامة. They mean here, أكثر أهل المذهب, the majority of the people of the madhab. That's what they mean. And there's also another taqseem which they have for the term mutaqaddimin and the mutaakhirin. The way I meant, well, there was one I mentioned, which is salaf and khalaf and sah and mutaqaddimin, they use. They also have something they call mutaqaddimin and the mutaakhirin. And it's another way that they do it. What's the other way that they do it? For example, when they say ذهب المتقدمون إلى كذا وعند المتأخرين كذا, the intent behind the word متقدمين here is, it is علماء الحنفية الذين أدركوا الأئمة الثلاثة. It is every imam who met Abu Hanifa or met Abu Muhammad al-Hasan al-Shaybani or met Abu Yusuf. Anyone who met those three is from the متقدمين. Are you there? And the mutaakhirin are those who didn't meet those three a'immas. That's another way that they divide things. Are you there? So whenever they mention the mutaqaddimin and the mutaakhirin together in an issue, you need to know this is what they mean by it. But if they randomly just mention the word salaf somewhere, or they mention the word khalaf somewhere randomly, or they mention the term al-muta'akhirun is randomly in a place, then it's as I told you before. They also have terms that are referred to as their books. They're terms that they now use for their books. When they say al-aslu, al-aslu, wa fil asli, what do they mean here, asl? The mabsoot of Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. Are you there, brothers? When they say wafil usuli, if they make asal plural now and they say wafil usuli, usul, they make it plural. What are they referring to? Kutub al-sitta. Kutub al-sitta. Wafil usuli, they mean kutub al-sitta. The books that we mentioned, Zahir al-Riwayah, that Muhammad al-Hasan al-Shaybani authored. When they say wal mutun thalatha, and the three mutun. When they say the three mutun, what do they mean? وفي المتون الثلاثة the three متون the مختصرات. Which three مختصرات are they referring to? So let's, the first one is the مختصر القدوري they're talking about, number one. The second one they're talking about is وقاية الرواية written by محبوبي, and the third one is كنز الدقائق by, written by نسفي. These three are called المتون الثلاثة. They call this what? Mutun al-thalatha, the three mutun. What's the first one? Mukhtasar al-Quduri. Mukhtasar al-Quduri. The second is Wiqayat al-Riwayat lil-Mahbubi, written by who? Al-Mahbubi. The second one is Kanz al-Daqa'iq, written by Nasafi. Yeah? You there, brothers? Written by Nasafi. These are referred to as al-Mutun al-Thalatha. There's what's called al-mutun al-arba'a, the four mutuns. The four mutuns are the three that I already mentioned for you. The Mukhtasar al-Quduri, Wiqayat al-Riwayat by Mahbubi, and the third which is Kanz al-Daqa'iq. Those three added onto it al-Mukhtar by Mawsili. That's one opinion, that the Mukhtar al-Mawsili is the fourth one. Others have said, no, the fourth one is Majma' al-Bahrain by Sa'ati. Sa'ati's kitab, Majma' al-Bahrain is. So there's a dispute. What about when they say Mabsoot? When they say Mabsoot unrestrictedly, we just read, we see Al-Mabsoot. If they say Al-Mabsoot here, they mean Al-Sarakhsi's kitab. Al-Sarakhsi's kitab. They don't mean Al-Imam Muhammad Hassan al-Shaybani. Muhammad Hassan al-Shaybani, they refer to his one as Al-Asl. And Al-Itlaq. Unless they say Al-Mabsoot written by Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, and they restrict it. What about al-Muhit? When they say al-Muhit, they mean al-Muhit al-Burhani, written by Burhanuddin al-Bukhari, who died in the year 616. Very good. Now we're going to also mention mustalahat that they use, that Hanaf use, when they are actually doing tarjihat, they're strengthening opinions and views in the madhab. Like the Ahnaf, you have to realize they're very daqiq in their terms. Very daqiq, mashallah. For example, when they say wa'indahu, wa'anhu is different. Wa'anhu and wa'indahu is different. In English, we just say from him, huh? Wa'anhu, wa'indahu, there's a farq between the two. For example, if they say وعن أبي حنيفة وعند الإمام وعند أبي حنيفة وعند الإمام, and when they say وعن أبي حنيفة وعن الإمام, it's too different. When they use the word وعنده, it means أي يعني أن مذهبه كذا, that his madhab is this. But when they say وعنه, they mean the narration that has been transmitted from him. الروايه عنه كذا. The riwayah that has been transmitted from him is this. So the عنده is talking about the madhab itself, and the عنه is talking about the riwayah that's been transmitted, the narration that's been transmitted. And which one is more comprehensive, madhab or riwayah? Madhab. The madhab is more أوسع من الرواية. What about if they say عليه عمل الأمة? This is the action of the Ummah. What do they mean? To them, the Ummah is the Hanafiyyah. So they're trying to say that the Ijma'u al-Mutaakhirina min ulama'i al-Hanafiyyah, they mean. They mean that this is the consensus that is connected by the latecomers from the ulama'u of the Hanafi madhab. If they, for example, say, alayhi al-fatwa, alayhi al-fatwa, the fatwa is in this regard. What do they mean? Especially you find this in many of the kalam of Ibn Najim. He says, ذَهَبَ مَحَمَدُ الْحَسَنِ إِلَى كَذَا وَكَذَا وَعَلَيْهِ الْفَتْوَى. And the fatwa is in this. He means here that this is أَصَحِيَّةِ هَذَا الْقَوْلِ. This qawl is sahih. And the fatwa should be given based on this opinion. If you're given a fatwa in the Hanafi madhab, it should be based on this statement. And there's a difference between عليه الفتوى وبه يفتى. عليه الفتوى وبه يفتى is two different things. سقلدنا. Don't confuse the two. There's another one called وبه يفتى. وعليه الفتوى. Do you see why I say to sometimes students of knowledge that they spend a lot of time looking at these terms and what imam means and what the madhab means? Why it may sometimes cause you to not be a mujtahid? Have you realized? Because you're going to busy yourself a lot learning terms of the Imam, but you still haven't dealt with the Nusus al-Wahyayn. صح? عرفتم? Are you there, brothers? You're not learning an Aam or a Khas, a Mutlaq or Muqayyad or Mujmal or Mubayyan. Sometimes it can make you tire a person. And it can keep them in the fold of blind following for a long, long time. Okay? As long as the person learns the Manhajiyya properly from the beginning and he does everything correct, he starts with the right book, does the next book, and the next book, and the next book, until he gets the final book, understands the madhab, he then has the rights to say, I agree or disagree. But if you don't know nothing, who are you to agree or disagree? Sah? Agreeing and disagreeing comes from a preconceived mindset. A person who's previously got something. So when he sees the knowledge, that's information that's coming to him, he's able to say yes, and he's able to say no. A jahil can't say no or yes. Sah? There's only one way open for him, is to say yes. Naam. Sah? So there's a difference between alayhi al-fatwa wa bihi yufta. Alayhi al-fatwa wa bihi yufta. There's a difference between the two. I think you guys should go look at it, inshallah ta'ala, research it. The difference between alayhi al-fatwa wa bihi yufta. Again, another term that they use, al-asahu and as-sahihu. Al-asahu and as-sahihu. What do they mean by this? They mean rujhan al-qawl. This qawl is the strongest in the madhab. Sahih means, are you there, brothers? Sahih means this is the strongest opinion. Okay? Okay. But when they say al-asahu, it shows that there is another opinion out there. Al-asahu is a comparative. It shows that there's another compared opinion which this opinion has been chosen from. Okay? They also have a term which they say al-mu'tamadu kada. Al-mu'tamadu kada. Mu'tamad means here what we rely upon. That's what they mean. They also use the term al-awjuh, al-adhar. The word awjuh and al-adhar, according to the Ahnaf, is the same. And al-awjuh and adhar is any opinion that has come strong to the individuals given the verdict according to the Hanafi madhab. Okay? الَّذِي ظَهَرَ رُجْحَانُهُ لِلْمُفْتِي. So awjuh and adhar is what's meant. What about al-ashbah? Al-ashbah is anything that's strong and it's closest in meaning. Like there's no, it's not as strong as the word asah. It's ashbah here, it means ma kana rajihan wa aqraba fil ma'na lil marwiya 'an al imam. And it is the closest thing that has been narrated from the imam. So for example, if somebody said something and then people are views that are there, the person would say this is the most closest in appearance to this imam. What about when they say jara bihi al-urfu? Jara bihi al-urfu. Jara bihi al-urfu. Jara bihi al-urfu means that at that particular time, then this was the norms. This was what people would do. So here we're going to now order al-fadhu al-tarjih inda al-hanafiyya. Ahnaf, when they are strengthening an opinion, this is the level that they take, and this is the order it would be in. The first and the strongest way that they will strengthen an opinion is when they say alayhi amalul ummah. If they say alayhi amalul ummah, this is the strongest. Okay? Or if they say alayhi amalul a'immah, both of them are the same. That's the strongest. And then next comes what? Bihi yufta. And then comes after, alayhi al-fatwa. And then comes after, al-asah. And then comes after, as-sahih. This is turuqu al-fadhi al-tarjih inda al-hanafiyya. According to the Hanafis, this is the sequence and the order of when they want to strengthen an opinion. Now this, my beloved brothers and sisters, is a very summarized knowledge pertaining to the keys to the madhab al-hanafiyya. We're now, inshallah ta'ala, after the break, we're going to go into al-madhab al-maliki.